Jesus. Oh, what a merry Christmas day. Snowflake covered country lanes, Jack Frost painted window panes, twinkling stars on Christmas trees. Oh, what happy memories gathered round the fireplace. Families filled with love and grace from the peaceful embers glow. Blessed Yuletide spirits grow, grow and grow, grow and grow. Joy to the children far and near. What a wondrous time of year. Isn't it just grand to say, Merry, Merry Christmas,
Merry, Merry Christmas,
Merry, Merry Christmas,
Merry, Merry Christmas.
Oh, what a Merry Christmas Day.
Marley was dead to begin with. There was no doubt about that. Scrooge knew he was dead. And Scrooge and Marley had been partners for I don't know how long. But Scrooge was a stingy, miserable old man. One Christmas Eve, Scrooge was working in his counting house with his clerk when Scrooge's nephew passed in.
A Merry Christmas, Uncle Scrooge.
Bah, humbug. What Christmas than another time of finding yourself a year older but you're not an hour richer?
Don't be angry, Uncle. Come and join me and my wife for Christmas dinner.
You got married? Why?
Because I fell in love.
Because you fell in love?
Scrooge said this, as if there was only one thing in the world more ridiculous than a Merry Christmas.
Good afternoon.
I'm sorry to find you so morose, but I shall keep my Christmas humour to the last. Merry Christmas.
Good afternoon.
And a Happy New Year.
Good afternoon.
A Merry Christmas to you too.
And to you.
There's another one. My clerk, a wife and family, and he still speaks of Merry Christmas. I'll retire to Bedlam.
This lunatic, in letting the nephew out, let two others in. They were Scottish gentlemen.
Are you Mr. Scrooge or Mr. Marley?
Marley died 7 years ago this very night.
No doubt his surviving partner shares his liberality. We're making some provisions for the poor. Is it this time of year that wants it most felt?
But are there no poor houses?
Plenty of those, to my regret.
Oh, I'm glad to hear it. I help to support those poor houses. The badly off must go there.
Many would rather die than go there.
Then they'd better do it, and increase the surplus population. Good afternoon, gentlemen.
Seeing they cannot pursue their point, the gentlemen passed away. For the rest of the day, they had no more visitors, save the owner of one cold young nose, who sang a carol at Scrooge's door.
Good King Wenceslas looked out on the feast of Stephen, when the snow came round about, deep on Christmas Eve, and brightly shone the moonlit night, the...
What do you want?
Pay for the sub, Governor?
Get out of here!
And the singer fled, leading the door to the fog and frost. At last, the time came to close the shop, which Scrooge grudgingly embittered to the waiting clerk.
You want the day off tomorrow, I suppose, and yet still be paid for the day.
The clerk observed that it was only once a year.
A poor excuse for picking a man's pocket every 25th of December. I suppose you must have the whole day. Be here all the early next morning.
The clerk promised he would, and trudged happily home to his family, while Scrooge went to serve the melancholy dinner. then spend the rest of the evening receiving death money or arranging extensions due to Christmas.
There you are, Jenkins!
Good evening, Mr. Scrooge. Have some free hot broth. There'll be a free can of broth every night for the coming year, in gratitude for your infinite kindness, in giving me another 2 weeks to pay my debt.
1 week?
10 days?
1 week. I'll take that stuff home with me.
As you wish, Mr. Scrooge. A Merry Christmas to you.
Humbug.
He lived in chambers which had once belonged to his partner.
Boss my buffers, Jacob Marley!
Scrooge was startled by this, enough so that he looked through his rooms to see that all was right before he settled for the night. But all was as he should be. Quite satisfied, he settled by his fireplace.
It's humbug still. I won't believe it.
But then it came. Marley's ghost. But Scrooge still doubted.
Who are you?
In life, I was your partner, Jacob Marley.
Humbug, you may be just the cause of indigestion. Mercy, I must believe in you now. But why do spirits roam the earth, and why are you fettered?
Every man or locomotive must roam the earth, even if he has exposed in death in order to make up for not doing so in life. But roaming in life is, and would have been, much happier. As for my chain, I have forged it into my life. The strong coil you bear yourself was this long and heavy 7 Christmas Eves ago. You have labored on it since.
Please, speak comfort, Jacob.
The only comfort I bring is this. You have hope of escaping my fate. You will be haunted by 3 spirits.
That's my only hope?
Yes. Expect the first tomorrow when the bell tolls 1.
Can't I take them all at once?
No. Expect the second on the next night at the same hour. And the third on the next night. Last stroke of 12 has ceased to vibrate. Look to see me no more, and look that for your own sake you remember what has passed between us.
Scrooge tried to say humbug, but stopped at the first syllable. And as it has been a long night, he went straight to bed and fell asleep at once. Late that night, Scrooge woke up. It was so dark he couldn't see anything, so he listened for the nearby clock bell's toll.
A quarter past. Half past. A quarter to it. The hour itself. 1 o'clock. Strange. It's past 2 when I went bed, but no matter. It's time for the... Are you the spirit who Cummings foretold to me?
I am. I'm the ghost of Christmas past. I come for your welfare.
Much obliged.
But secretly, Scrooge thought a night's unbroken rest would be better to that end. The spirit must have read his mind.
Well then, your reclamation, come!
And with that, they went off from the city to the country.
Heavens, this is my childhood home!
These are my shadows of the past. They have no consciousness of us. the schoolhouse is all quiet desert for Christmas. There's one boy left.
Scrooge knew it. They went to the school, and he saw Scrooge as a boy.
I wish, but it's too late.
What's the matter?
Nothing. I just wish I'd given something to a boy who was cowling at my door last night.
The ghost smiled thoughtfully.
You didn't stay so lonely always. One Christmas, your father had a change of heart, and your little sister Fan brought your home. Your sister was delicate but had a large heart. She died a woman and had children.
One child.
True, your nephew.
Yes.
They then went from the school to the city warehouse. It was Christmas Eve once again. The spirit asked Scrooge if he knew the place.
Know it, I was apprenticed here. Why, it's old Sir Frizzwick. Alive again?
Well, 7 o'clock. Yo-ho, Ebenezer and Dick.
Why, look, there I am. I looked a lot like my clerk. There's Dick Wiggins, too. I never realized how much he looked like my nephew.
Hallo, boys, no more work today. It's Christmas Eve. Let's get this place ready for the party.
You would not believe how quickly the two men got the place ready. It was soon as bright and beautiful as a ballroom. Soon came a fiddler, followed by the guests. It was a wonderful party. Scrooge acted like a man out of his wits the whole time. He was very excited, remembering it all. The party ends at 11 o'clock.
Wait, time goes short. Quick!
And the scene changed again. Scrooge was older now and had a woman beside him.
It's no use, Ebenezer. You have found a new love.
What love has replaced you, Belle?
A golden one.
There's nothing as hard as poverty.
You didn't used to be this way. You used to be content with being poor.
I was a boy then.
You admit yourself you have changed. Well, I release you now. May you be happy in the life you have chosen.
And Belle left.
Leave me, spirit. I can bear no longer.
Scrooge found himself alone, and in his own bedroom. He reeled into bed and fell into a heavy sleep. Scrooge woke up in the middle of a snore. He had no proof that the clock had struck one, but he had felt he had been woken up just in time for the second spirit. He braced himself, expecting anything but what came, a ruddy light that shone outside his door.
Come out here, Scrooge.
Come out and know me better, man. I am the ghost of Christmas present. You have never seen the like of me before.
Never.
Have you never met any of my more than 1,800 elder brothers born in these later years?
I don't think I have. That's a tremendous family to divide for. Spirit, conduct me where you will.
Couple up to me.
When Scrooge did this, the scene changed. They were outside, and it was Christmas Day. People were carrying their dinners to the baker's shop. The spirit sprinkled a few drops on his torch onto their dinners. And on the people who were arguing.
Hey, you fool, why don't you watch where you're going?
Where I'm going? You should have been moving!
Wait, why are we arguing on today of all days?
You're right. It's a shame to quarrel upon Christmas Day.
And it was. God love it. It was.
Is there a particular flavour you sprinkle from your torch?
Yes, my own.
then invisible, they explored the suburbs of the town. And perhaps it was the spirit's pleasure which led Scrooge right to the home of his clerk, Bob Cratchit. He was not home yet, but most of his family was there. His wife, Mrs. Cratchit, his oldest son, Peter, his daughters, Martha and Belinda, and one of his youngest sons, Tiny Tom. They were all busy preparing for Christmas dinner. At last, Bob came home, carrying Tiny Tim, Tiny Tom's twin. While Tiny Tom was without blemish, Tiny Tim bore a crutch.
And how did Tiny Tim behave?
As good as gold. And better.
He said that he hoped that those who saw him in church would be reminded of who made beggars walk and blind men see.
They then sat down to Christmas dinner. There was nothing really fancy about it, but they were very happy, grateful, and content.
A Merry Christmas to all. God bless.
God bless us.
God bless us, everyone.
Spirit, tell me if Tiny Tim will live.
I see a vacant seat in the chimney corner and a crutch without an owner.
No, kind spirit, no.
If these shadows remain unaltered, the child will die. But if he liked to die, he better do it and decrease the surplus population.
Scrooge was grieved to hear his own words quoted by the spirit, but then he heard his own name.
Mr. Scrooge, I give you the founder of the feast.
Founder of the feast indeed! If he were here, I'd give him a piece of my mind to feast upon.
My dear, Christmas Day.
Well, I'll drink to his health for your sake and for the day's, but not for his.
The children drank the toast after her. Tiny Tim laughed of all, but he didn't care tuppence for it. The mere mention of Scrooge's name cast a shadow that took 5 full minutes to disappear. They were 10 times merry after that. Scrooge and the spirit left soon after. The spirit took Scrooge to several other places after that, including the house of Scrooge's nephew, Fred. Much they saw, everywhere they went, people were happy. Scrooge noticed as the night went on that the spirit grew older. He said nothing of this until the spirit's hair turned grey.
Are spirits' lives always so short?
My life on this globe ends tonight at midnight. Hark! The time draws near.
The chimes were ringing 11:15 at that moment. Scrooge was saddened by this.
Forgive me, spirit, but I see something protruding behind you.
You wish to know what it is? Look here!
And the spirit revealed 2 hideous children.
Spirit, are they yours?
They are man's. Their names are Ignorance and Want. Beware them both.
Have they no refuge?
Are there no poor houses?
The bell struck 12. Scrooge looked around for the spirit and saw it not.
Wait, the last stroke of 12. Marley's prediction.
The third and the next night, and the last stroke of 12 has ceased by great.
The spirit was ominous, covered in black. If it had a face, it could not be seen, and it did not speak at all.
I am in the presence of ghost of Christmas yet to come.
The spirit blew its horn for a moment, which could be only be taken for a yes. This was the only answer Scrooge received.
I fear you more than any spectre that I have yet seen, but I know you intend me good. Lead on.
they entered the city. The spirits boxed up a group of chattering businessmen. The spirit pointed in their direction, so Scrooge listened.
I only know he's dead.
When did he die?
Last night, I believe.
I never thought he'd die.
What has he done with his money?
I haven't heard. He hasn't left it to me. That's all I know.
It's likely to be a very cheap funeral.
Yeah, I don't know of anyone who'd go to it.
I don't mind going if a lunch is provided, but I must be fed if I make one.
Well, I don't care to go, but I will if anyone else will. I may have been his most particular friend. Bye-bye!
Scrooge knew these men, but he didn't know what was important about the conversation. However, he felt sure there was nothing to some hidden purpose. He decided it would help to solve the riddle if he found himself. However, he couldn't find himself there. Even though he's usually there was the time of the day. The spirit then took him to the shady part of the town. They stopped by the sea, where grey-haired, salty rascal sat calmly in the shed. He wasn't alone. A janitor, laundress, and undertaker's man were with him.
So you're back. I hope what you three took is profitable.
It is, trust me. Undo my bundle, Joe.
Back off. Mine first.
Not much. It's all I'm paying you for. It and no more.
I'm next.
Also, not much. There you go. I've always give too much to ladies, so don't ask for more.
And now undo my bundle.
What's this? Bed curtains? And blankets? All from his bed?
Precisely. Plus the shirt they was going to bury him in.
Well, you certainly were determined to make a fortune, and you're making it.
Scrooge was horrified by the conversation. He was disgusted they were marketing the port for themselves.
Ha ha. He scared everyone away in life to profit us when he died.
Spirit, I see now what has happened to this man could happen to me. I could be like this man whose death seems to have made everyone happier. Let me see some tenderness connected with the death, or these scenes I have just witnessed will haunt me forever.
The spirit took Scrooge through several familiar streets until they came to Bob Cratchit's house, which he had visited before. He found the mother and children sat around the fire, but they were all very quiet. The mother laid down her sewing work.
The cold hurts my eyes.
Not Tiny Tim.
They're better now. They grow weak by the candlelight, and I wouldn't want to show weak eyes to your father when he comes home. It must be his time.
Past it, actually. But I think he's walked a little slower these last few evenings.
Bob came in. He was very cheerful with his family.
So you went today, Robert?
Yes. It would have done you good to see how green the place is. But you'll see it often. I promised him that I would walk there on a Sunday.
My little child!
He broke down at once. He couldn't help it. He had to leave the room for a time. He came back happy again. They gathered round the fire. Bob told him of the kindness of Scrooge's nephew.
I felt like he knew Tiny Tim, and felt with us. However or whenever we part from one another, I'm sure we shall never forget Tiny Tim.
No, never, Father.
I am happy. Very happy.
Spirit of Tiny Tim, the child is a sense was from God.
Spirit, somehow I sense that our parting moment is at hand. Tell me, who is that man that brought so much happiness to the others?
The ghost took him through the spot of businessmen once again. Scrooge still could not find himself, even in his own counting house. Presently, they reach a scrapyard. The phantom pointed towards one of the graves. Scrooge approaching, trembling. On it was his own name, Ebenezer Scrooge.
No, Scrooge, oh no! I'm not the man I was! Why show me this if I'm past all hope? Assure me that I yet may change these shadows you have shown me my altered life.
As Scrooge begged to have his fate changed, the phantom dwindled into a shed post. Yes, and the post was his own, the shed was his own. Best and happiest of all, the time before he was his own, to make amends in.
I will live my life in the past, the present, and the future. The things that would have been can be dispelled.
He now rushed out of his shed.
I don't know how long I've been with the spirits. Never mind, I don't care. What's today, my fine fellow?
Today? Well, today is Christmas Day.
It's Christmas Day. I haven't missed it. The spirits have done it all in one night. Of course they can do that.
Of course they can.
Hello? Do you know the butcher's shop and if they've sold the prize turkey? Not the little one, the big one.
Oh, the one that's big as me, it's hanging up there right now.
Is it? Go and buy it.
Walker?
No, but I am in earnest. Buy it and bring the man, and I'll give you a shilling. Come back in 5 minutes and I'll give you half a crown.
Wow.
The boy was up like a shot.
I'll be right back.
I'll send it to Bob Cratchit. It's nearly twice the size of Tiny Tim.
Once the turkey was sent, he dressed himself all in his best and go out to the street. He had not gone far when he saw the Scottish gentleman who had walked into his county house the day before. Scrooge was concerned, but he knew what path lay before him.
My dear sir, Merry Christmas.
Mr. Scrooge?
Yes, that's me, and I fear it may not be pleasant to you. Allow me to ask your pardon. And will you have the goodness?
Bless me. Are you serious?
Not a far thing less. Will you come and see me?
We will.
Thank you 50 times, bless you. Jenkins, about your debt.
Please, I just need a little more time.
Your debt's cancelled.
Really?
It's my Christmas gift to you.
Oh, thank you very much. That's the nicest thing that anyone's ever done for me.
That afternoon, he passed to his nephew's house. took him some time before he had the courage to puff up to his door. Then he made a dash for it and did it.
Fred!
Bless my whistle, who's that?
It is I, your Uncle Scrooge. I have come to dinner. Will you let me in?
Let him in. It's a mercy he didn't shake his buffer off. He was at home in 5 minutes. It was a wonderful party. Oh, but he was early at the office next morning. He had a heart set upon catching Bob Cratchit coming late. Yes, he did. The clock struck 9, and no Bob. In fact, Bob arrived 18 minutes and a half late.
Hello? What do you mean by being late?
I'm very sorry, sir.
You'd better be.
It's only once a year, sir. I was making merry yesterday. It won't happen again.
I'm not standing for this any longer, and therefore I'm about to raise your salary.
Bob, for a moment, considered knocking Scrooge down with a ruler and whistling for help.
A Merry Christmas, Bob. I'll raise your salary and assist your struggling family, which we will discuss this afternoon. Make up the fire and buy another coal scuttle before you dot another I. Bob Cratchit.
Scrooge was better than his word. He did it all. And to Tiny Tim, who did not die, he was a second father. He became good a friend, master and man as a good city knew, and he knows how to keep Christmas well. May that be truly said to us, and of all of us. And so, as Tiny Tim ado, God bless us, everyone.
The season of the heart, a special time of caring, the ways of love made clear. And it is the season of the spirit, the message, if we hear it, is make it last all year.
Ho, 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 yes! Make it last a whole year!
Merry Christmas! And remember, it is the season of the heart, a special time of caring, the ways of love made clear.
Yes!
It's in the singing of a street corner choir. It's going home and getting warm by the fire. It's true, wherever you find love, it feels like Christmas. It's true, wherever you find love, it feels like Christmas. It feels like Christmas.